When LA Chinatown is mentioned, this is what most people think of: the picturesque central plaza between Broadway and Hill Street, filled with shops, cafes, traditional architecture, even a statue of Bruce Lee. But this wasn't LA's first Chinatown.
The original Chinatown sprang up over 150 years ago along a dusty adobe-lined alley about a mile away. That was where one of the darkest incidents in Los Angeles history took place, the Chinese Massacre of 1871. On the night of October 24th, 1871, a mob of about 500 Angelenos converged on the Chinese part of town. They killed cooks, laundrymen, a musician, even a well-respected Chinese doctor. Not that they had done anything wrong. The problem was the color of their skin. This was the largest massacre in LA's history, and it was the last massacre marking the transition of Los Angeles from a Wild West town to a modern city that lived under the rule of law. I was born and raised in LA, part of the fourth generation of our family to lay down roots in this city. But as I was growing up, I never heard about the story of the massacre from our parents. They didn't mention it. It wasn't taught in school. Nobody talked about it. But the story of violence against marginalized people, blacks, Latinos, Asians, Native Americans, is part of the LA story. And it's still a story that reverberates today. In order to remember the forgotten history, we're going to take you along a trail of blood and tears. We're going to see the actual sites where the massacre of the Chinese in 1871 actually happened. Let's get started. Now we're at Father Serra Park. This is where North Los Angeles Street and Alameda Street come together. Behind me is Union Station. Across the street over there is El Pueblo, which is where Spanish settlers first created what later became the city of Los Angeles. What you may not know is that North Los Angeles Street used to be called Calle de los Negros, or what some Angelenos used to call Negro Alley. This is where the original Chinatown began.
I think some believe that Calle de los Negros got its name because of the darker skinned, complected folks that lived along this kind of alleyway. This moniker came prior to the Americans and the Anglos that came into Los Angeles, and it could have identified any group of people. It could have been indigenous, could have been Chinese, Mexican, Californios. So those that just had a darker skin complexion, it wasn't racialized just yet.
The downtown of Los Angeles at that time looked a lot like Tucson or Santa Fe. It was Mexican architecture, single-story adobes. The Chinese who moved into the neighborhood of Calle de los Negros did whatever they could to try to make the neighborhood feel like home. And so even though these were adobe buildings, they would string Chinese banners and Chinese lanterns. Calle de los Negros had once been one of the most desirable neighborhoods in Los Angeles. In the 1830s and 40s, the prominent California families built their homes there. By the early 1850s, by the time the Chinese arrived, Calle de los Negros was a neighborhood that was deteriorating. A lot of brothels and saloons had opened there, and along with them came knife fights and gun fights. And so it soon became known as the roughest neighborhood in town.
So in Los Angeles in the 1850s, there were two documented Chinese. By the 1860s, there were probably about 14. By the 1870s, just a little bit over 200. So about 234 people that were there. They came down into this area because of the fact that, number one, the mines up north, the gold mines up north, were drying up. I mean, the reality was that they were pushed out of the northern mines, and many of them, because of the foreign miners' tax, were pushed out of the mines. The railroads have been completed. Others were seeking different labor and fulfilling a vacuum of labor in Los Angeles because of the gold rush. And so many Chinese, and predominantly Chinese men, they were in Los Angeles working as laundrymen. They were working as houseboys, or what was considered houseboys, you know, by the Anglo population. They were working as vegetable peddlers, some were farmers, because Los Angeles now didn't look like Los Angeles then. There was a great deal of green spaces in which Chinese did work as farmers, and they did so up and down California. So many of them, majority of them, were just like kind of low-level laborers.
Calle de los Negros was the roughest part of frontier Los Angeles. Virtually everyone carried a knife or a pistol. One historian wrote that violent mayhem was almost a daily occurrence in this part of town, and among the perpetrators were the Chinese. It was here, late on the afternoon of October 24th, 1871, that a gunfight broke out between gunmen from rival Chinese gangs.
The Chinese community of Los Angeles was small at the time, fewer than 200 people, but it wasn't really united. Part of the problem was that differences that had divided people in the homeland would resurface in California, but these disputes were also based in commerce. Business was very competitive in the Chinese Quarter at that time. And so you have these rivalries develop mostly among the leading Chinese businessmen at the time. Starting in 1870, the rivalries between two Chinese factions started to become more intense. And one of the incidents that caused the most commotion in the Chinese Quarter was in March 1871, 7 months before the massacre, when members of one faction abducted the beautiful young bride of a wealthy merchant in the other faction, and they married her to one of their own men. And this created a huge uproar. And so the tensions between these two factions continued to simmer during all of the summer of 1871 and into the fall. By October of 1871, one of the factions decided to bring in some professional Chinese gunmen from San Francisco, because the other faction had staged a series of incidents to retaliate against them, and it had caused enormous tension among the Chinese community. There was a gunfight around sundown on the evening of October 24th. There was a lot of shooting between the two factions. And of course, since the Chinese Quarter was downtown, a lot of people heard this noise and they started running to the Chinese Quarter to see what was happening.
Calle de los Negros was a very short street. It ran for one block from Father Sarah Park over here to parking lot 4. The gunfight on October 24th continued along the calle. A little after 5 o'clock, one of the Chinese gunmen was shot. He fell to the ground and died, maybe somewhere right around here. You've probably heard the Joni Mitchell lyric about how they paved paradise and put up a parking lot. Well, Calle de los Negros was not exactly paradise, but like so much of old LA, it was paved over and became this parking lot, the buried history of Los Angeles. Now, we're gonna go over here to Arcadia Street and turn right. There were two Chinese gunmen shooting wildly at each other on Calle de los Negros. When police officer Jesus Bildarain heard the shots, he leaped onto his horse and charged into the fray. The gunmen tried to scatter, but Officer Bildarain was able to catch one of the gunmen and started marching him here up this way on Arcadia Street. We're now near the current point where the 101 freeway and Los Angeles Street cross. This was the site of the Coronel Adobe. The Coronel was built in 1840 by Ignacio E. Coronel, a former Spanish Army officer. His son Antonio later became mayor of Los Angeles and California State Treasurer. By the 1850s, when the Chinese started to arrive, the Coronels had moved out and other people moved in. Dr. Qilong Tong was one of the best known Chinese in the Los Angeles of 1871.
He had his home and his office here in the Cornell building. But the building also had less reputable businesses, such as bars, gambling houses, and brothels.
Dr. Tong, who, you know, at the time in the 1870s, he had his wife with him, which was very, very unusual, not just for a Chinese man, but actually any man in Los Angeles, because the majority of the population were men. He was one of the only herbal doctors in town. He probably did pretty good business because Chinese herbal medicine, traditional Chinese medicine, was actually very well known in California. He probably served not just the Chinese community, but he served other communities who were also very familiar with herbal medicines.
Not surprisingly, the Cornell developed a reputation as a place where violence and even death became common. It was so bad that one of the local newspapers, the Los Angeles Herald, wrote that the Cornell block serves a man for breakfast every morning. So it's no surprise that it was here that the violence of October 24th began to spread out of control.
It was about 5:30 in the afternoon, a Tuesday afternoon in Los Angeles. A guy named Robert Thompson had been the owner of a saloon, very popular guy, well known. When the shooting broke out, he took it upon himself to engage with the shooters. He was armed. He went up to the doorway of the Cornell building and foolishly stood in the doorway and fired into the dark. Somebody inside the building returned the fire, hitting him. Eventually, he passed away. The crowd grew. Word spread that this Robert Thompson died about 7:30. And the word went out in the crowd, and the Chinese were killing white folks. The conditions in the city of Los Angeles had been that the Chinese were looked upon as being aliens. They looked different, smelled different, ate different foods, dressed different. And in practice, they were looked upon as taking jobs away from the rest of the community. So they the Chinese, were not well liked, maybe hated. And so as the word spread that Mr. Thompson had passed, now the crowd had grown to as many as 500 folks. 10% of the population of Los Angeles had surrounded the building. Vigilantes climbed up on the roof, poked holes in the roof, shot through the openings, celebrated what they could see in the execution of some of the residents inside. They threw fire. Frankly, the shooters had escaped, and really the only people in there, in the building served for merchants, stores and residents. So those were the only people in there. The innocent folks had nothing to do with the shooting. As they continued to attack the building, some of the residents inside, some of the Chinese inside, tried to make a break, tried to escape. But you know, when you've got 500 folks surrounding the building with guns, knives, hatchets, and clubs, you don't get very far.
We've just walked a few blocks over here to Spring Street. Now we're in the heart of the Civic Center. I'm standing in front of the U.S. Courthouse. Over that way, across the street, is the Hall of Justice. L.A. City Hall is across the street that way, and another block over is the headquarters of the L.A. Police Department. With all these symbols of law and order around us, it's hard to escape the irony that we're near the spot Tomlinson's Corral up on Temple Street where the hangings began. Vigilantes were dragging Chinese up Temple Street. Some of them already had nooses around their necks. Five Chinese were hanged near here at Tomlinson's Corral. One of them was Dr. Tong. According to newspapers, he tried to plead for his life in both English and in Spanish. Dr. Tong offered his tormentors gold and silver, but when they found that his pockets were empty, they shot him, then they hanged him.
They identified him They went in the building, drug him and his wife and his housemaid out. Some folks thought they would be taking him to jail, in essence, to protect him. But again, the mob took control. The way hangings traditionally would occur is that the person is placed on a platform, rope is tied around their neck, the platform is pulled away, or a door is opened, they fall, and the fall breaks their neck, and then they suffocate. The breaking of the neck's important because it allegedly cuts the pain. That's not how they treated the housemaid. They put the noose around his neck, hoisted him up off the ground, hoisted him up and bounced him against the wood cross member that they hung him against, crushing his skull against the cross member, bouncing him down on the ground, hoisting him up, bouncing him down, hoisting him up, bouncing him down, hoisting him up, you know, crushing his skull until he expired. And at least one occasion, the hanging wasn't quite effective enough, and an individual climbed up on top with the victim hanging on the rope and then jumped up and down on his shoulders to make sure that he was very dead. Other examples of the hangings were people were hoisted up where they the neck was not broken, but they were strong enough to reach up and grab above their head and keep themselves from suffocating. And the vigilantes, the mob, would beat his hands, crush the bones in his hands until he had to release and suffocate and die. It's terrible, the inhumanity that occurred.
A witness to the carnage, 15-year-old Joseph Mesmer, later testified, "It was a heinous and gruesome scene. I have seen a good many men hung, but nothing so revolting as what befell these Chinese." Let's move on to the next scene. Behind me is the Los Angeles Mall, an office and shopping complex near City Hall. If you went down there on a regular workday, you'd see office workers from City Hall, the Federal Building, or the courthouses picking up their lunch, going to get their laundry, or going into the drugstore. But long before the streets were paved and cars ruled the city, this location was a scene of horrific cruelty. One local newspaper described the mob as worse than wild beasts. Here in this block was Galler's Wagon Shop, where seven Chinese were hanged. Nearby, another two Chinese were hanged from an upturned wagon on Commercial Street.
The violence and the killing ended approximately 9:30 that evening. So the whole, quote, massacre would have occurred from 5:30 to 9:30. 4 hours. The good citizens did not retire to go home. Many of them went back to the local saloons and bars to celebrate. The next day, the newspapers, and there were more than one newspaper covered the city of Los Angeles. Some of them reported it, frankly, as it was an embarrassment that the citizens had taken the law into their own hands, that it was simply inappropriate behavior, that we, the city of Los Angeles, could no longer be looked upon as a vigilante outpost of the wild, wild west. Interestingly, there were other newspapers that celebrated the violence that had occurred, describing it as a glorious night, ridding the community of the fiends among us. A very terrible day for those individuals, for the Chinese community and the city of Los Angeles.
It's hard to imagine that this was once the place of great suffering, but it was also a place of refuge. William Slaney was the owner of a boot and shoe store. On the night of the massacre, he protected some Chinese by locking them inside his store to keep them safe. Another person who tried to help was William H. Gray, the Justice of the Peace. He owned a vineyard on the outskirts of town around present-day Broadway and 7th Street. On the night of the massacre, he sheltered several Chinese men and women, hiding them in the cellar of his vineyard. Imagine what it must have been like, running for over a mile through the dark, looking for safety, but unsure of whether you would find friend or foe. On the night of October 24th, 18 Chinese never made it to safety. Let's move on. This is the pedestrian bridge over Temple Street near City Hall. It connects the north and the south ends of the Los Angeles Mall. But in 1871, Temple was just an unpaved street. Up the hill was the city cemetery where the bodies of the victims of the massacre were buried. Later, the remains were shipped back to China so that they could be buried in their homeland in accordance with Chinese custom. For the Chinese, the cemetery was a place of mourning, but it also became a place for healing.
A daju is a Taoist ceremony. It's a rather elaborate ceremony that requires Taoist priests to lead in prayers, in chants, in burning of incense and candles, and burning of sayings to wish the spirits a safe journey. It took 10 months before the community was able to put on the first daju ceremony. From the records, we know that the community had to raise $8,000. That's a lot of money in 1872. So I'm sure it took a long time to raise that money. And that money probably was not only raised in Los Angeles, but probably from San Francisco, from Sacramento, from everywhere where large numbers of Chinese lived, because it was just such a major atrocity that happened to the Chinese in LA. The priests set up their altars in the proximate area where the massacre took place in 1871. And so we think it's in the area of Calle de los Negros where the altar was set up. It has to be a very elaborate altar with lots of incense burners and burners for money and houses for the departed, along with fruits and vegetables and food on the altar, and then the gods that represent who will be receiving them or protecting them as they maneuver the afterlife. There'll be a beginning ceremony at that altar, and then the priest would lead the Chinese people, whoever wants to participate, to the city cemetery where the massacre victims were buried. At the cemetery, there'll be other rituals and ceremonies. When the Taoist priest led the group to the cemetery, to the site where the victims were buried, then again, it'll be a repeat of what was done at Calle de los Negros, but then it'll be carrying up like a whole pig and a whole chicken and a whole fish along with vegetables and rice, and then also wine and tea and all the things that would be needed to feed the victims in the afterlife to make sure that they're full and they're taken care of. This is a ceremony for those who died. But then we heard that in 1 year, a dragon was added. Dragons are celebratory types of inclusions in parades. We have dragons for the New Year, we have dragons and lions for weddings and birthdays. So when I read that, it seemed almost inappropriate to have a dragon involved in a Dajiu ceremony. Everyone does things for different reasons. And I think the Chinese, in order to start developing positive relationships with non-Chinese, and especially with the Anglo people, the white people who were living nearby, began to say, hey, this is one way of introducing our culture to those who don't know us, and then maybe we can befriend each other and have a more positive relationship. So it kind of evolved into more of a social cultural event, and as a introduction of our culture, our Chinese culture, to non-Chinese people.
I've seen many Golden Dragon parades in Chinatown, and I've even ridden in some. But now, when I see the dancing dragons, I'll think about what happened in a different Los Angeles 150 years ago. Let's go see one more spot. Now we've reached the last stop on our tour. We're here at the Chinese American Museum, part of the El Pueblo Historical Monument. The museum is located in the Garnier Building, built in 1890. It's now the last remaining building from Old Chinatown. When you're here, you'll want to check out this plaque in the sidewalk.
The plaque summarizes the events that occurred. It's in English and in Chinese, but the lettering is so small. I don't know that someone standing looking at the plaque could ever read it. It's truly an understatement of what has occurred, and hardly an appropriate recognition for the violence and pain that occurred. When we look back, there was a trial, although there were 500 people participating in the mob violence and the vigilante killings. Only, I think, 9 were identified and prosecuted that were convicted. And then a year later, on appeal, their convictions were overturned and they were released. On a technicality, somehow, it had not been established that someone had been, quote, killed, and therefore the convictions all failed. The laws at the time actually prevented a Chinese person from testifying against a white person. Holy cow. How do you get a conviction when all your victims, all the firsthand witnesses, are not allowed to testify? It's nuts.
In many ways, I grew up in Chinatown and never left Chinatown. Never did I know that there was something called the Chinese Massacre of 1871. Not until I was associated with the Chinese American Museum. And even then, we didn't know about it. We thought, why aren't we doing this? It happened in our front door. And because it's not written into our history, right, meaning U.S. history, it doesn't mean that we can't draw attention to it and tell it, because our museum is to educate about the history of the Chinese in America. The next year, we actually then commemorated with the reading of the names at El Pueblo. The reading of the names is what we have in our archives through English newspapers and court records. So we have 18 names, but they're all spelled out, they're anglicized. So with Chinese names, unless we see the characters, we really don't know what their names are. And in traditional Chinese culture, the most horrible thing that can happen to a person is to die nameless. And because we couldn't tell what those names were, and the Chinese didn't have a newspaper in 1871. So we have names like Ah This and Ah That, and those are basically nicknames. You don't know if Ah Hong, whether it's somebody named Hong or his last name is Hong. Those are the things that, to me, is devastating, because we don't know who they are, in essence.
I grabbed my kid, 8-year-old son, and We came out here on the 24th of October, a decade ago, and simply said a few words in respect for those who passed. I thought it was important for my kid to know what his knucklehead father didn't know. I think it's extremely important. You know, how we view the past shapes how we imagine the future. And those of us who do not know what occurred potentially could repeat it.
So Coronel Adobe, it's interesting because it serves as a metaphor for this history. This is where the violence erupted, but you know, within the next 15 years, it was completely demolished and replaced, right? So a street runs right through it. The buildings that were once made of adobe, which spoke to the California and Mexican past, this was, you know, destroyed. And then in its place, you know, these kind of orderly buildings made out of brick. Literally, we have paved over our history. And we have destroyed this evidence of violence, the evidence of blood that happened in Los Angeles to create Los Angeles.
We usually present a wreath to those who died. And then I lead the three bows to their spirits so that they know that there's still people on Earth who remembers.
You know, in thinking about those that passed, it's painful. I mean, I know the first time that I contemplated you. One could imagine that, hey, that could have been my dad, it could have been my son, it could have been me. And you think about what didn't occur, all the poems that never got written, or the songs that never got sang. And you know, there really is an obligation to remember what occurred and to memorialize so that others can be educated and we can stop that kind of activity.
Is a sidewalk plaque the best way to remember the tragic events of 1871? Or could there be a better way to educate the public about the bitter realities that made Los Angeles the city that it is today? At present, all we have is the plaque. A few years after the massacre, Calle de los Negros literally was wiped off the map and merged into North Los Angeles Street. A few years after that, the Coronel Adobe was demolished. And then in the mid-1890s, the city cemetery was closed. We can't bring those places back, but as the historian Scott Zesch wrote, the very act of remembrance is one way of restoring our blemished past.